Thank you for the invitation to talk today about the most common periodic fever syndrome in children, which is periodic fever, aphthous stomatitis, pharyngitis, and adenitis syndrome, or FAPA, or PFAPA, if you want to say an extra syllable. It's, like I said, it's the most common periodic fever syndrome in children, but the exact incidence and prevalence of the syndrome isn't well characterized. In a study from Norway, the incidence was reported to be 2.3 out of 10,000 children under the age of 5, but we believe that the syndrome is likely underdiagnosed because we frequently see patients in our clinic who come to us with a diagnosis, previous diagnosis of recurrent viral infections or even recurrent strep pharyngitis who actually have this syndrome. Cases of FAPA have been reported around the world, including in the United States, Europe, Middle East, East Asia, and in South America. I wanted to share with you the typical presentation we see of patients with FAPA. So this is a 3-year-old girl who's presenting with recurrent fever episodes that are identical to each other. And the parents report that something that tipped them off that this might not just be recurrent viral infections is that the episodes were occurring with regularity to the point that they could predict approximately when the next episode would occur and started planning their vacations and family events around that. And they referred to it as her fever menstrual cycle. And it happens, her episodes were happening pretty regularly every 4 weeks. Her episode started when she was 18 months old, and usually the flares last 4 to 5 days, and during them she complains of sore throat and has been noted to have a tonsillar exudate and cervical adenopathy during the exam. She's had numerous rapid streps and throat cultures that are always negative, but has been on antibiotics anyway, and the fever doesn't seem to respond. But besides this, she's otherwise completely healthy, asymptomatic between her flares, and has normal inflammatory markers between flares as well, although during the flares, she has elevated inflammatory markers. So these are the clinical features of several cohorts that have been reported of patients with FAPA from around the world. So as you can see, the age of onset is typically between 1 to 3 years of age. The average duration of each episode is anywhere from 3 to 5 days. The average interval between episodes is usually about 28 days, but for each patient can be anywhere from 3 to 6 weeks. The cardinal features of the disease, which are in the name, are pharyngitis, cervical adenitis, and aphthous stomatitis, and they're present in the majority of patients who are diagnosed with FAPA. Usually, on exam, patients have an erythematous pharynx and often can have exudate as well on their tonsils. The cervical adenitis can be tender, and it's usually bilateral. The aphthous ulcers in the mouth are usually on the buccal mucosa and usually smaller than a centimeter in size. But in addition to these symptoms that are around the oropharynx, patients often have symptoms outside of the oropharynx as well, including headache, abdominal pain, myalgias, and arthralgias. But there are some atypical symptoms that usually tip us off to consider other periodic fever syndromes or other diagnoses, and those include patients having prominent vomiting or diarrhea, arthritis, rash, and chest pain. These are images of patients during their flares. On this side, we have a patient who has aphthous ulcers, and here there's a patient who has exudative tonsil inflammation during their flare. So the natural history of FAPA is for episodes to resolve, usually after an average of about 6 years. Usually patients start having resolution of their fevers before puberty. In this long-term study, which was conducted at Vanderbilt, patients were followed for about 10 to 20 years after their diagnosis. And among the 60 patients that were followed for the maximum period of time, 9 had persistent fever. The rest of the patients completely stopped having episodes. And then the patients who had were continuing to have episodes, the episodes were shorter and were occurring less frequently. In this cohort, no long-term immunologic sequelae were reported in these patients, although one patient was diagnosed with Behçet's disease, and I'll come back to that connection in a little bit. I also think it's important to ask about family history in these patients. We've found that about 25% of patients with FAPA have a family member who meets the diagnostic criteria for the disease, and usually it's inherited with the autosomal dominant inheritance. But in addition to that, there's a lot of family members who have a history of so-called recurrent tonsillitis, recurrent strep, recurrent aphthous ulcers, or tonsillectomy. And so I think it's important to elicit this history. I always try to ask about all of these entities because sometimes it can support the diagnosis of FAPA in the patient. These are the original diagnostic criteria that were released in 1989, shortly after the initial reporting of this disease. And the main features are that the episodes had to be regular. They had an early age of onset. At least one of the symptoms during a flare had to be aphthous ulcers, cervical adenitis, or pharyngitis. And patients had to be asymptomatic between their flares and otherwise have normal growth and development. However, since the 30-ish years, since these patients were first reported, numerous patients who don't quite meet the diagnostic criteria but sort of fit the criteria for FAPA, respond to the treatments, have been reported. So we frequently find that patients might skip episodes or have periods of remission ranging from months to years. We find patients who don't have an early age of onset. In fact, we've seen several adult onset cases in our clinic. There are patients who appear to have none of these cardinal features during their flares, but otherwise respond to the treatments, including tonsillectomy. And then some physicians recommend trialing a dose of steroid and that a rapid resolution of the flare with one or two doses of steroids should be part of the diagnostic criteria. Because of these various exceptions to the diagnostic criteria, other groups have tried to come up with new sets of criteria that might be more sensitive and pick up more patients. So this was a classification criteria that was developed by a panel of 22 experts who reviewed the histories of a lot of patients with FAPA, and they came up with this set of classification criteria. Out of these eight features that are listed here, they said a patient, in order to be classified as having FAPA, had to have seven of these features, and this had a higher sensitivity than the original criteria that I just showed you. The main diagnoses that are in the differential diagnosis of a patient with FAPA are recurrent upper respiratory infections or recurrent pharyngitis, but the lack of stereotypical nature of the flares, and that every episode is identical to the other, and the regularity and the presence of URI symptoms may tip the scale more in favor of recurrent infections. I do want to note that some patients do come to us with a diagnosis of recurrent strep, but some of these patients are actually colonized with strep, so it's important to make that distinction as well. Cyclic neutropenia is another diagnosis on the differential, and like FAPA, flares in cyclic neutropenia occur with precise regularity. However, patients with cyclic neutropenia tend to have neutropenia prior to the onset of fever and can also have gingivitis on their exam and may have true bacterial infections during those periods of neutropenia when they have fever. And other periodic fevers are also on the differential, and many of the speakers today will be talking about those other fevers, and Dr. Simon will be talking about HIDS, which may be difficult to differentiate from FAPA as well. So what causes FAPA? The pathogenesis is still understudied, but the data that we have from the peripheral blood and tonsils of patients with the disease suggests that there's myeloid cell activation in the tonsils. So this includes the dendritic cells and macrophages in the tonsils. And once they're activated, they lead to activation of CD4 positive T cells in the tonsils, and that leads to systemic inflammation and fever in the flare. And then during the asymptomatic phase of the disease, there's a compensatory suppression in which all of these inflammatory markers normalize. But what triggers the initial myeloid activation in the tonsils? So we believe that FAPA is likely a complex genetic disorder that's caused by particular genetic variants that predispose patients to the disease, but there are likely environmental triggers as well that that modulate this genetic predisposition and lead to the initial myeloid cell activation. We've recently found that common variants that were previously associated with Behçet's disease and recurrent aphthous ulcers are also significantly associated with PFAPA. So this commonality in the genetic variants between these two ulcerative diseases puts PFAPA on this on a spectrum with both of them. And as clinicians, we frequently see patients who fall somewhere on this spectrum as well. Like sometimes we see patients who meet the diagnostic criteria for PFAPA but who have vaginal ulcers. Sometimes we see patients with who meet the diagnostic criteria for PFAPA but will have some flares without fever but just recurrent aphthous ulcers. So I think this commonality, this spectrum of disease may teach us a lot about this disorder as well. Oh, since the natural history of PFAPA is for there to be spontaneous resolution of the disease, and most patients don't seem to have long-term immunologic sequelae, some providers will choose not to treat patients symptomatically with NSAIDs and wait for the episodes to resolve, and that is an acceptable form of treatment. And so a big role factor in that helps us decide what treatment to use for a patient is the effect of these episodes on the quality of life of a patient and family. So that sort of plays a central role in how we decide how to treat a patient. But I like to group the treatment options into three categories. So flares can be treated episodically, which means treat at the onset of a fever with the corticosteroid or anakinra. Can provide preventative treatment, which means giving treatment every single day in order to prevent a future flare. And surgical therapy can be given with tonsillectomy, which has the potential to completely stop episodes and potentially cure the patient of the disease. So corticosteroids are usually given once or twice during a flare. And as I mentioned before, there's usually rapid resolution of the fever following administration of steroid. And that rapid resolution may be diagnostic in this disease. Unfortunately, about 20 to 50% of patients who receive steroid have an increase in their episode frequency, sometimes as much as every 10 days. So that can limit the use of steroids in some of these patients. Another option for episodic treatment is anakinra. So in a study conducted here at NIH, patients who just received one dose of anakinra had a reduction in their fever and inflammatory markers after receiving the dose. Where we frequently treat patients here with anakinra who've been refractory to the other treatment options, and I often find that they need multiple doses during a flare in order to contain their symptoms. One of the preventative treatment options is cimetidine, which is actually an antacid. It's an histamine 2 receptor antagonist, but it also has effects on the function of myeloid cells and lymphocytes. And in patients with PFAPA, about 25% who take daily cimetidine are reported to have complete remission of their flares, and another 33% have fewer episodes and episodes of less severity. We've actually found that cimetidine is particularly helpful in patients who continue to have flares after tonsillectomy. It's actually one of the most effective treatments in that group of patients, and we're currently studying why cimetidine is helpful in this disorder. Colchicine is another preventative treatment option. Most of the studies that have been conducted of colchicine in PFAPA were conducted in populations with a high rate of pathogenic MEFV variants. So whether it's applicable to a broader population isn't well studied. But in those groups, anywhere from 50 to 90% of patients had a decrease in their episode frequency when on colchicine. And lastly, tonsillectomy. In both observational studies and in controlled trials, anywhere from 60 to 100% of patients with PFAPA had a complete resolution of symptoms following tonsillectomy. We follow quite a few patients who've undergone tonsillectomy, and we found that many of them have recurrence.
that many of these patients have recurrence of their episodes, sometimes even years after the tonsillectomy, but it still can be a highly effective procedure in many patients. And of note, many patients, even after the tonsillectomy, might stop having their fever flares, but most keep having aphthous ulcers. And this is the treatment approach that we use. So usually when we see a patient, we trial prednisone or prednisolone, and if a patient doesn't have a complete response to that, we do consider alternative diagnoses, although there's a fraction of patients with PFAPA who may not completely resolve with one or two doses of prednisone. However, if prednisone leads to more frequent episodes or if the episodes are increasingly disruptive to a patient's quality of life, then we try other options. Usually, we use this cutoff of using more than 2 milligrams per kilogram of steroid per month, although this isn't a data-driven number, but it's sort of based on the experience of many rheumatologists and infectious disease physicians who we queried. So if a patient wishes to try other treatments, we go to either the prophylactic therapies with cimetidine or colchicine or to tonsillectomy, and this decision depends on the patient and the family and what their preferences are as well. And in patients where all of these treatments are ineffective, we consider anakinra, and as I mentioned, in that group who continues to have episodes after tonsillectomy, cimetidine seems to be particularly useful medication. And it may also be a good time to consider alternate diagnoses in patients who don't fully respond to tonsillectomy. So with that, I'm happy to take any questions. There's time. Mm-hmm.